My life and testimony. Welcome to this second portion of Care Ministry. I may be a Christian from birth, accepted Jesus as Savior a long time ago, but it did not really mean that I personally knew Christ or the Bible. I am still a sinful man. I make mistakes on a daily basis and always ask God for forgiveness. I made a promise to God a long time ago that I would testify my awful sin about my fatal auto accident one day. I think the time is now or never. If it was up to me, I would just keep my secrets to myself, but the good Lord see it differently. If rescuing and saving my life from the time when I was born without a father, my adoption into a new family, my experience going through the Vietnam War, fatal car accident and divorces are not worth telling other people about, then I think I am just one ungrateful soul and doing God a disservice here. The only thing left for me to do is to get on my knees, confess my sins, tell Him how sorry I am for being selfish, turn my life around and live for the Lord 100%. Heavenly Father, please bless my ministry, my listeners, and use my music to bring others to You. May You and You alone be glorified. We need to keep in mind that Jesus is the center of attraction here, not my products or I. You are, however, feel free to grab a copy of my products at www.sawcub.com. I would like to make my products available to those who want it. More importantly, we need to do what Jesus commanded us to do. Matthew 24:14 reads, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." The good Lord walked me through many valleys of death and bad situations in the past. Now that I got the wake-up call and am getting older, my life is shifting spirituality. It all boils down to investing in the kingdom of God more than investing in the things of this world. God created the heavens and earth in Genesis 1:1, I am a part of His vast creation. That goes for you too, Satan. You can never beat or outsmart the giver of life, author of wealth, Lord of lords and King of kings. Matthew 6:19-20 says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal." Nowadays, I have begun to be more aware of Satan's three deadly temptations, which started as far back as Genesis or 4000 BC in 1 John 2:16. It reads, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." Adam and Eve fell for the lust of the eye easily. They ate the forbidden fruit restricted by God to test their love, faith and obedience to God. They, unfortunately, failed the test and handed over the dominion of this world to Satan willingly, which was a very bad idea to begin with. Sin entered this world. The wages of sin is death. For Satan, there will be no second chance but death in the end. We, however tempted by Satan, are given a second chance to be saved. Since the fall of Adam and Eve, we are not able to get out of this whole mess. Jesus, therefore, had to come down to earth to rescue us by paying the ultimate price for our sin on Calvary's cross. God did it that way to remind everyone that it was our sins that nailed Jesus to the cross. In other words, God's plan for putting Christ to death was to redeem us for eternity. It is written in 2 Corinthians 5:21, "He made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him." Also in Romans 5:8 and 6:23 it speaks of how He died to pay the penalty for our sins. As long as Satan and sin still exist, there can never be purity, holiness, perfect peace and tranquility on earth until another cleansing of the earth with fire is to take place. Remember how the earth was cleansed once with water during the flood of Noah? This time He is going to make sure it is being taken care of once since for all with fire. It is only then we will see a new heaven and a new earth, no sin, no pain and no death. In Revelation 21:1, it reads, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea." Satan and his wicked angels knew that their time was short. They, therefore, had to do everything in their powers to drag as many people as they could into the lake of fire. He is the father of lies from the beginning. Be alert and don't be fools. When I see Jesus face to face, I want him to be able to say, "You did a good job in conducting your life, with the resources I gave you and being such a faithful servant to my cause till the end, you may be with me." Matthew 25 hours 21 minutes says his Lord said unto him, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things, enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." I, however, feel as if I am letting him down and have not been doing a very good job in managing my life in general. I am still trying very hard every day asking the Holy Spirit to teach me what is right and what is wrong. Keep in mind that nobody has immortality but God. 1 Timothy 6:15 Who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen, nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15:53 For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. At least we all have something in common, death. James 4:14 says, "Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time, and then vanisheth away." We have to understand the purpose of our existence. We are just vessels for God to use to bring him glory. Lord, please continue to mold me like clay for your kingdom. It reads in Ecclesiastes 12:13, "Fear God, and keep his commandment, for this is the whole duty of man." Satan tempts, but God tests. God wants to see if we have genuine faith in him. Even Jesus himself was tested when he was on earth in his 30s. After John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the Jordan River, the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness, high mountain, high Jerusalem cathedral, and was tested. We too, undoubtedly, will be tested in order to validate our faith. Whatever God plans to do with our lives, it is for our own good and he doesn't go beyond our abilities. God tested Abraham, Job, and Jonah just to name a few. The Israelites, God's own people, were tested on many occasions and more often than not, failed to believe in their Creator miserably. It wasn't that these temptations weren't hard to bear or impossible to complete, but rather used to teach about faith and dependency on the Father. God could easily stop everything bad from happening in a single breath, but sometimes allows it to happen so that we as his people will learn to have faith in him and him alone. When we as people lose that faith, it oftentimes leads us onto paths filled with sin and destruction, and ultimately away from God himself. The Lord is so very good to me. I was given a second chance to turn my life around after an awful auto accident. I don't want my life probation or legacy on earth to expire with shame, disgrace and without any contributions to my Lord. It almost did during the night of Y2K with my horrible auto accident on the Interstate I-90. Not many people survive an accident like mine and are able to talk about it afterwards. God rescued and saved me for a purpose. I almost ended up inside a coffin and 6 feet underground. Of all the mistakes that I've made in my life, the Ho-Chunk Casino fatal automobile accident is one of my most embarrassing moments for two reasons. 1, I am a Christian, and 2, my accident was tied to a gambling trip. That is why it is hard for me to testify or present a sin like that to the public. As bad as I may feel, the fact of matter is the sin was tied to gambling. I am most certain, assuming that I had died, most of the people who knew me or would come to my funeral would probably have concluded that it was all about gambling and for a very poor cause. That would have been a total loss. Brothers and sisters, if you have been hiding a dark secret or sin inside of you for a long time, it is better to confess it all to God today, because you may not be given another opportunity to do so. God knows also. Don't try to hide any. In Acts 15:18 and 1 John 3:20 it speaks about how God is omniscient or knows all things. Psalm 115:3 and Revelation 19:6 reveals that God is omnipresent or all-powerful. In addition, Jeremiah 23:23, 24 and Psalm 139 tells of an omnipresent God, or a God who is present everywhere. It is a miracle that I am still here, standing and alive talking to you. I am living example, I am not speaking to you from an out-of-body experience or an after-death experience. I, however, must apologize for one more thing before I move on. Due to my bad concussion from the fatal car accident, I nowadays can't remember all the facts or details of how or what really happened to me during that night. In order to get my facts straight, I had to consult my cousins and reflect back on my ex-wife's story in order to reconstruct the scene. Perhaps, the good Lord didn't want me to have this kind of nightmare or flashback for the rest of my life. That accident really screwed up my head for good. It caused me to have short-term memory loss and permanent minor disabilities. Despite that, the accident makes me exercise daily to alleviate my chronic health problems and to stay healthy. Not many people, given the same situation, are even alive to talk about it. During the night of Y2K, December 31, 1999, after eating and celebrating at China One Buffet, my ex-wife and I could have called it a night. Instead, we decided to conclude the second half of our Y2K celebration at Wisconsin Dells Ho-Chunk Casino by having a little fun playing blackjack and slot machines. It was meant to be a very innocent trip. Maybe going to casino, in God's eye, was a bad idea to begin with. We knew in our hearts that gambling and God didn't really mix. We were just inviting Satan to take charge of our lives. The car accident took place about 40 minutes before the midnight. The night was young and cold with blizzard snow. The road was beautiful but very slippery. The winter had just begun to kick in Wisconsin. It was the kind of night that a TV weather reporter would probably recommend drivers to stay inside. We got out of Ho-Chunk Casino before midnight, feeling sad and defeated and filled with regret. We got inside the car arguing and drove away in the blizzard snow. As I was picking up more speed, coming around the curve merging onto Interstate I-90 from Baraboo, and my car slid out of control. It skidded to the left lane of the freeway and got stuck in the snow. I couldn't get myself out of the situation. Behind me was a semi-truck, going at highway speed. He saw what happened in front of him and tried to slow down, hoping to minimize the damages yet knowing that the accident was unavoidable. Things happened so quickly and within a split second, the semi ran into me on the driver's seat, pushing my small 1998 Toyota Camry all the way to the right side of the shoulder like a little toy. The airbags really saved the both of us. I was completely unconscious by this time. You can probably can imagine this scene in your head: loud crash, shattered glass, debris flying all over the place and blood were everywhere. The ambulances, paramedics and fire trucks all arrived about 30 minutes later. My car was completely crushed, damaged and towed. The emergency team had to remove the car door in order to get to me. They didn't know if I was still alive or not because there was just too much blood everywhere. They checked for my pulse. I had a pulse. My heart was still beating. I had a 50-50 chance despite heavy external and internal bleeding and major bodily damages. My life was at the mercy of God and the medical team. Oxygen and breathing tubes were critical at this point. My ex-wife and I were rushed into a nearby small hospital in Baraboo for further assessment. She sat in the car next to me but wasn't hurt as severely as she was released a couple of hours later. The doctors informed my relatives in Madison of the shocking news. They said that I might or might not make it through the accident. Therefore, it's important that they needed to come to Baraboo Hospital right away. On hearing the bad and sad news, they also drove in the snowstorm to get to the hospital. Hours later, my relatives informed my sister and brother-in-law of the situation about 2 a.m. in Aurora, Illinois. Everyone, included my mother, sisters and relatives, said they prayed like they never prayed before. They asked the good Lord to save me because I am the only son in my family. My mother almost fainted when she heard the bad news. Anyway, the small hospital in Baraboo, unfortunately, was not properly equipped to handle first-class emergencies like mine. The UW hospital helicopter couldn't give me a lift either under these bad winter conditions. The Baraboo ambulance and medical team then had to transport me all the way from Baraboo to the UW Madison hospital, which took close to 2 hours to get to. Nobody knew if I was going to pull through or not. I spent 2 weeks in NICU and 2 weeks in a regular room. My left ankle required surgery right away to put the ankle back in its place. There was a big cut on my head that required many stitches. My ex-wife and mother spotted some leftover tiny broken glasses on my head that the doctors missed and removed them. I had a temporary coma and a very bad concussion. Many people tried to scream very loud into my ears hoping to wake me up, but I heard nothing. My niece Bixicon played my Volume 1 and 2 albums over and over again to help improve my memory. My nephew Dao burned me a copy of CD opera music to ease my mind. The part that I hated the most was when the doctors kept asking me what month, day and year it was. My mind just went blank, or I would answer them incorrectly every time. They said, "You are not ready to go home just yet." One of my biggest challenges was when I had to learn to talk and walk like a baby again. I felt so weak and lost a lot of weight. The scariest thought on my mind at that time was not being able to keep my FT teaching job at the college because of my health condition. Anyway, as my memory began to return slowly, I couldn't remember many people, especially my family members and relatives. Once when I asked them what happened to me, they said I just had a very terrible car accident. As a defensive driver all my life, I was not going to accept an answer like that. One thing was for sure though, I was glad that I didn't die or have major disabilities for life. I learned to think, use a wheelchair, walk on crutches, and received intensive inpatient and outpatient therapy sessions. My total hospital bill was $76,000. I don't know whether or not that is a lot, but that bill caught my ex-wife by surprise. She started to worry a lot about the bill, my medical insurance, job situation and my long-term permanent disabilities. My work medical insurance eventually did cover the bill because I was a full-time teacher on annual salary. I was just out for a winter break. My ex-wife became angry at a dying man who couldn't he help himself now. In feeling that way, she began to treat me disrespectfully. She thought I was never going to recover back to my normal self ever again. Besides, she wasn't willing to put up with my permanent disabilities for the rest of her life. Maybe that was her conclusion, but that was never mine. Our marriage started to slide downhill from there. While I was recovering at home, my mother was still holding a full-time job and my ex-wife only worked part-time. They both didn't have time to cook or care for me, so my aunt, Yur Yang, came to take care of me. During that same year, one icy winter morning, my mother unfortunately fell on the ice and broke her two left collar hand bones. She then had to quit her 15 years of full-time employment working with the UW University system washing dishes in the tower's student dormitory. That really made the whole situation very hard for all of us. My mother and I both were out of jobs. The future didn't look very good. My mother was only 61 years at that time and wasn't quite ready to receive any sort of SSI benefits. My ex-wife helped her to get SSI benefits while she held a part-time job. All of the bills and major responsibilities were now on her shoulders. The mortgage, credit card bills, and household responsibilities, all were stacking up to the ceiling and my credit was deeply affected. We were at the brink of losing everything. We went to see the state collection agency to settle matters. I was in the middle of my recovery and was not able to assume any major responsibilities. My aunt, the person who came to cook for me during my recovery, died from cancer not long after that. My marriage began to collapse and eventually ended up with a divorce decree. Our irreconcilable differences were beyond repair. To set the record straight, my ex-wife and I were legally married twice. At the end of it all, it was better that we went our separate ways. From 2000 to 2007, I spent all of my time simply getting well. In 2007, my mother's gardening friend and neighbor introduced me to her younger sister who was still in Laos and had a beautiful daughter. One thing led to another, and in 2007 I went to Laos to tie the knot. She came to the United States in 2008. My mother was a great contribution towards my new marriage. She died from spleen cancer in 2013. Despite many setbacks, God has blessed me with a wonderful marriage and together we have three children. All conceived in grace, the three kids are God's blessing to this marriage. Now, I am functioning normally, You wouldn't notice any differences unless you read my story. My memory is not sharp like it used to be. The numbness on my right leg is chronic and I exercise every day to help with that. My ongoing health problems, my divorces and scars, all serve as reminders of my disobedience to the Lord. God put me through a series of life actions, some were good, some were tough, but all tested my genuine faith and dedication to Him. In the end, He ended up loving me so much and was willing to give me a second chance. That is more than anybody could ask for. A promise to God is a promise to be kept. A follower of Christ is a follower to the end. A life surrendered to Christ is a life of new leads and direction. The moment we accept Christ as our personal Savior, we are dead to the old self. Christ is the center of our lives from then on. We can no longer be self-centered and continue to live the old way. Life with Christ shouldn't be dysfunctional, lifeless or filled with boredom. As matter of fact, there are better things we can do that are far more productive and meaningful than self-seeking pleasures. This time I am not going to throw my life away for no good reason. I am going to allow the Lord to guide, mold and take charge of my life completely. In the midst of constant hardships, an orphan childhood, an adoption, a victim during the Vietnam War, oftentimes without food and constant bombings, chased by the communists through the jungle, an escape swimming to Thailand and the Mekong River to freedom as a political refugee, living in different refugee camps and after moving to America, struggling to pursue an education and live the American dream. Throughout all of that and then followed by my car accident and divorces, I want my life to have meaning, a legacy to leave behind. I don't want people to feel sorry for me or that my life boiled down to a night of gambling. That would have been a total loss. My testimony proves that God is loving, merciful and He gives people a second chance. I hope you read my testimony with an open mind and not quick to judge. The Bible says in Luke 6:37, "Judge not, and ye shall not be judged, condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned, forgive, and ye shall be forgiven." I don't know about you, but I am taking God's word seriously. Ecclesiastes 9:10 says, "Whatever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might, for there is no work, nor device, no knowledge, nor wisdom, in the grave, whither thou goest." God's grace is sufficient for me. 2 Corinthians 12:9 reads, "And He said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness." Last but certainly not least, I also want to leave you with some very important Bible verses to guide and empower you as well. In the end, Jesus is all that matter. Keep in mind that there are always two choices and two masters that we have to pick to serve. You can decide to end up in heaven with Jesus or in the lake of fire with Satan. Matthew 16:26 reads, "For what is a man profited, if he shall gain the whole world, and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" Jesus commanded us to take His message to the whole world before the end comes. Mark 16:15 says, "And He said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature." I want my testimony and ministries to bring Christ's glory, honor and resonate His truth and love. The Apostle John puts it best in John 3:30, "He must increase, but I must decrease." Satan, his wicked angels and the unrighteous, which includes many of us, will one day be judged and pay the ultimate price in the lake of fire. That is why Jesus is offering a better alternative on the cross. You can be saved through Jesus and have salvation. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." In John 14:6, it reads, "Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father, but by me." I don't know about you, but this time I am going to do everything in my power to be with Christ and to be part of the first resurrection. As it says in John 5:29, "And shall come forth, they that have done good, unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil, unto the resurrection of damnation." Life on earth is corrupted and sinful. Without Christ's second coming, intervention and fire cleansing of the whole earth, Satan and sin will continue to exist. Take some time to imagine the devastation of how the earth will be like after Jesus is through with the first resurrection. It tells us in Malachi 4:1-4, "Behold, the day cometh, that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly, shall be stubble, and the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch." The Bible can't be any clearer than that. Keep in mind that Satan is a defeated enemy. The devil is not in charge of hell. Hell was made to destroy the devil. It is in the Bible, Matthew 25:41. "Then he," the Lord, "will say to those on his left, Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." Refuse to cooperate, obey and bow down to Satan. I want to end this second part of my ministry with an invitation for you and the lost to come to accept Christ before it is too late. It tells you how to do so in Acts 16:31. "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved." We can receive Jesus Christ by personally inviting him into our lives. Jesus said in Revelation 3:20, "Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in." If you would like to accept Jesus' free gift and become a child of God, you can pray this prayer now. "Lord Jesus, I need you. Thank you for dying on the cross to pay the penalty for my sins. I ask forgiveness for my sins and receive you as my Savior and Lord. Thank you for giving me the gift of eternal life. I want to turn and live a new life with you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Amen."